I have visited St. Petersburg a couple of times before, but this time I feel I've really seen some parts of it, and it's a wonderful city, and you're all lucky to study here. If we talk about this book, you know, I think the reason why it has sold 1 million copies is that if you are not very tall, you know, you can sit on it, and then it makes you look taller. So I think a lot of it sold to short people, you see. That's why it was so successful. Anyway, I'll speak in English, and if there's anything you don't understand, put your hand up and we'll try to explain it. We're going to talk about culture. You are mainly young people, and I'm sure that you will travel abroad. Russians are traveling all over the world now. We have many in London, a lot in Finland, and I'm sure that the opportunity will arise for you. And you know, you get a lot more out of traveling abroad, whether it's for work or for holidays, if you know a little bit about the people. And we live in a wonderful world, you know. We have 300 countries, and certainly 200 major countries. They're all different. They all have different cultures. You go to Finland, which is very near, you'll find people behave rather differently. If you go to Japan, you'll find they behave very differently. And you'll wonder why they do this and why they do that, and so forth, you know. Why do Europeans shake hands, and why do Chinese and Japanese bow? You know, there are reasons. Japanese don't like shaking hands. These are superficial things. But all I can do today is to examine what is culture, first of all. What is it? And how do we get it? You all have a culture, and it's a strong influence in your life. It makes you behave probably like a Russian. And I behave like an English person sometimes. So we'll examine culture, and we'll talk about the differences in culture. I'll look at about 7 different cultures with you. The main countries, you know, Britain, United States, but particularly European, Germany, France, Spain, and Italy. And if you travel to these countries, although they are different from Russia, you will find that in every country there are some things which you have in common with them. And there'll be a lot of things which are different. So what you're doing when you're traveling and trying to get the best out of your experience abroad is balancing, you know, the differences and the likenesses. And we'll look at that country by country. But we'll start by, what is culture? I think what we might do possibly is, could we kill one of the lights, perhaps this light? Is that possible? To get a better picture for you? Yeah, is that better? You know, when I'm teaching culture, there are many ways to do it. You can use many words, and I use a few words myself. But I like to teach things, not only culture, but what I can, through images, through pictures. I try to draw certain things. And one thing I find very difficult to draw is the word culture, or the concept culture. How would you draw culture, you know? I've tried, and I'll show you what I've done. But anyway, first of all, you know, what is culture? And I try to draw it. So wish me luck. This is what I've come up with. So I've drawn here a kind of cloud. But cloud is not a good word, because cloud is a bit negative. Let's say it's an atmosphere. Now, how did you acquire your culture? Well, first of all, you were not born. This is before you were born. This is you here. And then you are born. And the moment you are born, you enter into a culture, which in your case is the Russian culture. You enter into it. You have no choice, you know. Your parents are there. You're in St. Petersburg. And this is St. Petersburg. And you enter this atmosphere. Because it was lying in wait for you. It was here before you were. And so you enter this wonderful thing, Russian culture. And if you stay inside this cloud for 12 years, when you come out, you are not only Russian, but you will always think like a Russian. Psychologists tell us that 10, 11, 12 years is a formative period where you acquire the habits of a lifetime, the mentality of a lifetime. Therefore, those of you who were born in St. Petersburg, you will always project Russian culture, Russian habits, behaviors, possibly St. Petersburg behaviors, if you are different from the people in Volgograd. So that's it, you've got it. And normally you won't change. You can emigrate to America perhaps, as some families do. Many Italians go to America. But it depends when they go. I know two Italian families who emigrated to New York, and they each had a son. And one son was 3, and the other family had a son of 12. And they both went into American school, the older one, in high school, and the little boy of 3 went into a kindergarten and then into school. And the older one learned English and began to work for IBM. But all his life he was regarded as an Italian American. He spoke with a slight Italian accent. He was always rather Italian in behavior. He was part of the subculture. Of course, he became a useful American in the economic sphere. But he was always kind of, he was Italian American. But the other one, in kindergarten, after 3 months, he was completely American. And he went through life being an American. Nobody knew, apart from his name, that he was of Italian origin. Because he was in that formative period where entering a school with other American children and so forth, he had the same experience as any American, and he became an American. So the point I'm making is that it's very difficult for you if you've had at least 12 years, and particularly with parents, you never change. You may acquire some American characteristics. When I lived in Japan for 5 years, and I'm English, when I went to Japan for 5 years, I changed, not much. Here I still think English, you know. I think about cricket and rugby and all the things that English people think about. But you know, I became a little more polite when I went to Japan after 5 years. Because you know, Japanese are very polite. They usually address you like this, and even when you're talking to them, they have a slight forward posture. And while I didn't do that exactly, over 5 years there, I became more polite. But I was still English. But you acquire some characteristics of them. So remember, you're all Russians, you're going to be Russians, and there's nothing wrong with that. Now, there are many different kinds of Russians, and there are many different layers of culture, of course. Just think, what layers of culture do we have? National. We've talked about national culture. Can you give me another layer of culture?
Regional.
Sorry?
Regional.
Regional, yeah. For instance, okay. For instance, people from Volgograd are a bit different from people here, yeah? So in Russia you have many regions, and therefore you have a lot of subcultures. And it's the same in the United States. And in England it's the same. We have Scots and Irish and Welsh. So, of course, we are British, but we might be Scots-British, and you might be St. Petersburg Russian or Moscow Russian. And then we have the professional level. An engineer does not act in the same way as a salesman. He might be Russian, he might be from St. Petersburg, but if you start talking to them very quickly, you will recognize the culture of the engineer and the culture of the salesman or saleswoman. They act differently. So that's another thing that affects our character. So we're under a lot of influences in life. We're born in Russia, we're Russian, we're St. Petersburger, very proud of it, we're a teacher, and we're either a man or a woman, in most cases. So that also is very cultural. Women are different from men, as the, you know, Rex Harrison told everyone. And then, of course, class. Well, we don't have many classes in some countries. In some countries we do. Religion will again affect your culture. Christian, Orthodox, Catholic, Muslim, secular. Generational. Have you heard someone say, my son, he's not like me, you know. He's not like I am. He's all right, but he's not like me. He's 25 years younger, of course. The thing about generational culture is it's temporary. In 25 years, my son will be like me. He'll be just as bad as I am, you know, in 25 years, but now he's all right. So generational culture is a transient thing. But it does affect the way people behave. Ethnic, you might be, you know, in England, you might be part Scots, you might be part Welsh, Irish. In Russia, you have a lot of different ethnic strains. And, if you join a company, you may become a Gazprom man. And that's quite different from, what's another Russian company, a Rosneft man, or whatever, right? So, you know, in America, you recognize an IBMer and an Apple man immediately. The difference. They dress differently, they act differently, even though they're Americans. So the corporate culture actually sometimes combats, you know, the national culture for some reason, or it may be in line with the national culture. Yes?
Let's invite people over there to come over and take spare seats.
But yes, would you like to come and take the best seats? The more expensive seats are over here. Would you like to come through? We have three places, maybe four. Any ladies still standing? And finally, after corporate, we have, you know, the most important one of all, personal. So at the end of the day, you know, you're Russian, you're from St. Petersburg, you're a woman, you're maybe Orthodox, you're ethnically, Great Russian, you work for a little company, but finally you are personal. So you're a complicated human being. Now, I said there are about 300 cultures in the world, countries in the world. There are 200 countries registered with the United Nations. But are there more cultures than countries or fewer? What do you think?
I think there is no more culture.
More cultures, yes. And why are there more cultures? Because in one country you have several cultures. So we probably have about 300 cultures. Now, if we in our organization are training you to go and function in Germany, for instance, or in Japan, we have to teach you the culture of that country. And it's not a thing I can do in one afternoon. I would need, perhaps, if you are going to Germany, I would need 2 days where I would tell you everything I could about Germany, the history, the geography, the economy, rather quickly, and then all the cultural traits. It's a kind of 2-day study. And of course it can be more than that. But when we deal a lot, 60% of our time we are teaching industry. 20% of our time we work in universities, and 20% of the time with governments. But we work a lot with industry. So if you have someone from Gazprom who comes and says, and I have given a lecture to Gazprom in England. He said, next week I'm going to Germany. I've never been to Germany, how shall I behave? Because I'm a Russian. I say, okay, we give you a seminar on Germany and we teach him. Now, he comes the following week and he says, next week I'm going to Holland. Do I need another seminar? Because I don't have time. We say, well, you don't have time, but we say there are such a thing as categories of cultures. There are three. In our books, there are three. And actually, the Netherlands, Holland, belongs to the same category as Germany. We call it linear active cultures. You know, linear. So, we've not time to train you to go to Holland, but if you go to Holland, behave more or less like we told you how to behave in Germany. You know, be punctual, be straightforward, don't talk too much. Try to be efficient, because the Dutch and the Germans in these respects are similar. So he goes to Holland and he comes back and he said, well, there was a bit of difference, but I managed all right. Then the next Monday morning he comes and says, I'm going to Italy. And then I say, well, forget about what we told you about Germany, because the Italians are completely different. They are in a different category which we call the multi-active category. And anything you do in Germany, you have to do almost the opposite in Italy. In Italy, you can show your emotions, and in Germany, you don't. And in Germany, you've got to be 5 minutes before the meeting, and in Italy, you can come 20 minutes after the meeting. Everything's different. Most things are different. So we have to give you another seminar. So the reason why we establish these categories, and we include everybody in the world in three categories, is to facilitate the study of culture in a way. Because it's very difficult for any brain to absorb the characteristics of 200 different cultures. You know, we could do it, but we would need about 200 years to do it. We would need a long time to do it. So we try to teach people. Now, we have established these cultures through testing, established these categories through testing. We have tested 56,000 people on the web. We can test you tomorrow, electronically. And you answered about 170 questions. And when you've answered those questions, I have your personal cultural profile. Because you've expressed so many preferences, I would do this, in this case I would do this, and so on. So I have your personal cultural profile, which is part of a national cultural profile. You might be typically Russian, or you might not. But I have you in a certain place in my diagram. And on the basis of 56,000 tests, we have established which people are most linear active, most multi-active, and we call the other reactive. So this is how we categorize these. Can you read that at the back? Can you read it?
Very.
Say yes if you can. Say no if you can.
Very.
They don't speak. You can speak it if you like, anytime. So here you see three different types of people. Linear active, going in a straight line, doing one thing at a time, talk about half the time, plan ahead step by step, polite but direct, partly conceal feelings, confront with logic, rarely interrupts, job oriented, stick to facts, truth more important than diplomacy, and so on. Respects officialdom. What kind of person do you see there? If you have been to Germany, you would know that that's rather typically German. Germans behave like that. But here you have a different kind of person entirely. Talks most of the time. Does several things at once. Is emotional. Displays feelings. Often interrupts. People-oriented, feelings more important than facts. You can see there the beginning of an Italian, can't you? Italian, Mediterranean, emotional person, warm-hearted, family is important. Quite a different category. And then there's a third category. This category listens most of the time and doesn't talk much. They are polite but indirect. They react to the partner. They don't talk, but they react. They try to please the other person. They never confront, conceal feelings, must not lose face, they never interrupt, very people-oriented, diplomacy is more important than truth. And they're very patient. And there I think you begin to see an Asian, a Japanese. And one or two European nationalities are partly reactive. One or two. So here we have three different types of human being. Most of us are a mixture of the three. So if you look at those columns and imagine yourself, what am I? Am I linear active? Or am I multi-active? Or am I reactive? I'm a Russian, but what am I? What kind of Russian am I? And you'll find that you're a bit of a mixture. But mainly, you will be in one column. See? Mainly, you will be in one column. If you can read that, hands up if you think you are mainly linear active. Put your hands up. Just a few, all right? Hands up if you think you are mainly multi-active. emotional. Come on. Hands up if you think you are mainly reactive. More of you, yeah. Okay, so you see you are a mixture. Russians are a mixture. But you will see in a moment what the testing gave us. Now, we give you this test on the web, and then we, after 56,000 tests, we are able to decide who is most linear active, who is most multi-active and reactive, and so on. And this is the result. Now, this is after 25 years of testing people. Russians come out to be quite multi-active, emotional, rather talkative, not too much. Not like the Italians, Spaniards, the Latins are up there, the Arabs, the Africans, they are all very multi-active people. Russians are somewhere between linear and multi-active. This figure includes a lot of people from southern Russia, because we have done more testing in southern Russia for various reasons. So actually, St. Petersburg people would be more here, this area. Rather similar to Poland or perhaps Belgium, yeah. A mixture of characteristics, and we'll go into those characteristics in a few minutes. The most linear active people are the Germans, the plodders, the planners, that's how they live their lives. And Americans and British, rather similar, but less than the Germans. Germans and Swiss and Luxembourgers are the real plodding people, the ones who plan ahead and live their lives in a very disciplined way, which some of us don't like. I mean, some English people are not quite here, they're more this way. If you look at Finland, your neighbor, they are more towards the Asians. They have Asian communication style. Finns, as you know, don't talk very much. Right? The most multi-active people are the emotional people, the Latins, the Mediterraneans, Portugal, Greece, Africans. They use a lot of body language. They're emotional. They like words. They have feelings are more important than facts, which a German would never agree with. Americans are quite factual also. Slightly less factual than the Germans. And then here you have, of course, the Japanese, Chinese and Vietnam. Korea, all very reactive. Reactive people are courteous, amiable, accommodating, compromisers, and good listeners. When you're addressing those people, they are nice, and quiet, and listen, so on. You can have problems with them, but to begin with, they are very quiet, peaceful people. Not always, but mainly. Here, of course, as you go up this way, you get more lively people. So Koreans are more lively than the Japanese. Indians are more lively than the Koreans. Even Bulgaria is on this side. It's a rather reactive country, Eastern influence, similar to Turkey. And then you get the Arabs and so on. Funnily enough, Canada is nowhere near the United States. Canada is halfway between the two. The Canadians are very quiet people. They are laid-back people. They're very different from Americans. So when we tested them, this is where they came, statistically. Quite a long way from the Americans. Very close to Finns. And you know, Nokia has a new chairman called Elop. He's trying to turn Nokia's fortunes around. And he's Canadian, and he gets on very well with here you notice these Japan is here, and then Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore are more linear. And that's because these countries are very interested in money. Singapore and Hong Kong were trading places. So they have this kind of, rather, money is a very linear thing, you know. So they behave a little bit like Westerners and so on. Now, when we test you, what do we do with you? We put you inside the triangle, and depending on your answers, you appear as a dot in the triangle. And this is a Swedish company we tested a couple of years ago, and that's where they are. Now, this was a technical company, and they appear in the linear corner. They were engineers. You would expect them to be here. But these four people were different. They were all Swedes. And finally, we had to ask these people, why are you more multi-active? And we found out that these three people were French. And this one was a Swede, but he lived in France for many, many years. And so they had a different character from these. So if we tested this group, you would all appear inside that triangle. And you would see your relation to each other, who was more linear, and so forth. If I show you another diagram, you know, we are advisors. I am an advisor to the World Bank. And this diagram is the HR department of the World Bank. And you know, it's quite an interesting diagram because, first of all, they are everywhere. Very different set of people. And you see that a lot of them are in the middle. And this was, for them, it was a good result. Because if you are in the HR department, human resources department, you are responsible for sending World Bank people out to different countries to lend money and do the work and so on. So if you are not an extremist, if you kind of, you're here in the middle, you have some affinity with linear people, you have some affinity with reactive people, you have some affinity with multi-active people. So if you're in the middle, it's a kind of mediator. So they were quite pleased with this. But of course, you see there's a weakness there. They didn't have anybody except this person in the Asian area. So they felt that, you know, who can we send to Asia to do certain jobs we need doing there? They only had one in this particular group, of course. Now, the interesting thing was that this person was not an Asian. He was a man, and very surprisingly, he came from South America. South America. Now you know the South Americans. They're lively. They're all multi-active. Most South Americans are here. So why was this man there? South American. Can anyone explain it?
He was atypical.
Sorry?
He was atypical.
You'll have to speak up.
He was unusually atypical.
He was African, did you say?
Atypical.
He was not typical, yeah. But well, he was typical of his country, but he was from a certain country in South America.
From Chile.
Not from Chile, no, but you're on the right track.
From Peru?
Which country was he from? Because he acted in a very Asian manner, but he was a South American. So where did he come from?
Well, they proposed Peru.
Well, that's a very good answer. It could have been Peru. It was not quite Peru.
It's Ecuador.
And it was not quite Ecuador. Keep going. It was a country where the origins are not Spanish. Yes? Begins with P.
Paraguay,
right. Now, why should a man from Paraguay be here? Because two countries in South America have a lot of Indian populations. Of course, many of them have, not Argentina much. Brazil, of course, is Portuguese. But of all the Spanish-speaking countries, and there are 19 of them in South America, two, Paraguay and Bolivia, have large Indian populations. They live in the Andes Mountains. And they're completely different in character from the South Americans. They are quiet, reserved, patient, and they don't talk too much. Now, why are South American Indians, this is a very cultural thing, why are they different from the excitable Spaniards, Argentinians, Colombians in the rest of South America? Why? But where did they come from? They weren't there at the beginning. 10,000 years ago, there were no people in South America. Where did they were only animals. So where did they come from? I'm sure you studied history and geography. Where do South American Indians, including the North American Indians, the Comanches, the Apaches,
well,
the Blackfeet, where do they come from?
From Siberia.
From Siberia, right. They came from Siberia. And at that time, 10,000 BC, Siberia was occupied by Asians. I don't think the Russians had got there, but they were Asian type Asians. And they look like Japanese, Chinese. The South American Indians look different from the Spanish South American people. And so these people, they crossed. How did they get from Siberia to America? How did they get there?
By the bridge.
By the bridge. Which bridge? Who built the bridge?
Bering Strait.
The Bering Strait. And how did they get across? You know, did they swim? Because the water is very cold. Huh? There was a bridge, a land bridge.
Yeah, land bridge.
Right. There was a land bridge, or even in winter ice. So they were able to cross. Finally, 10,000 BC, they crossed. And it took them 1,000 years to come from the top of Alaska to Tierra del Fuego, on the southern tip of South America. And that is a very fast migration, because it's a very long distance. So these people living in South America, and they're said in Mexico, and some in North America, but in North America they're not important at national level. But in South America, Bolivia, Paraguay, and to some extent Peru, there are a lot of Indians. And you know, the president of Bolivia at the moment is, what's his name, Morales. And he's an Indian, completely very different from the Spanish South America. So the reason why I'm pointing this out is that culture lives on, not 100 years, lives on 1,000 years. In these cases, their ancestors 10,000 years ago came from the Asian part of Siberia, you see. And so it's a very strong thing, culture. And so that explained why this man, there he was, working for the World Bank, didn't behave at all like the Spanish speaking of the World Bank, who were mainly up here, you know. And the Anglos were more up here. Okay, so I hope that makes you understand what a strong thing culture is. Are there any questions at this stage? Either about this diagram or this diagram. Are there any questions?
I might have, actually. Yes. Australians? Where Australians?
Sorry?
Australians, where do you place them?
Australians, they're here somewhere. Where are they?
Yeah, Denmark. Oh, that's, yeah.
Australia. Livelier than English people. Have you talked to Australians?
Yeah.
You know, they are much livelier than the British. So they are more multi-active. They talk more. They show their feelings more than Australia, than British. Any more questions about the diagram? Yes?
I think that there should be equal amount of...
You'll have to speak up because I'm a bit deaf.
Equal amount of people tested.
What did she say?
I think she means, did you actually test equal number of people from all the countries?
No. We have tested 56,000 people. I can't give you the exact numbers. Right. You know, many Germans, many French, but the people who take the test. Russians, I think 1,000, you can say.
Right.
But a lot of them were from the south, because we had connections in the south before we had connections in the north. Yeah. And anybody who comes to our school in England, we test them. We test each one who comes, we test them. But we had more Russians from the south. So, the numbers are not equal.
They might be different. If they're coming to study in England, this is different Russians from Russians which live here.
Yes, but we also have tested people in their own countries. Also in Russia, we have tested people in their own countries. But what you say is true. In other words, if you go to England, you're a little more adventurous than the Russian who stays all his life in Novgorod. Okay, but they're still Russians. Okay, but you can ask more questions later. You have plenty of time. Yes, you have a question. But you'll have to shout.
I think your argument doesn't quite hold. Just remember one other president, Hugo Chavez, who's also American Indian.
You tell me what he says.
Like, Spanish.
Okay.
What did he say?
He said that the example of another president, like Hugo Chavez, he's also an Indian. It contradicts your evidence.
He doesn't help.
So Paraguay is very strongly influenced by German culture. Are you sure that person wasn't Paraguayan, German?
Well, I have not said anything about the culture of Chavez or Morales. All I said was that Morales is an Indian. I didn't say anything else about him. He's president and he's an Indian. And he was the first Indian to be elected by the Paraguayans. I didn't say anything about him. And Chavez, well, he's Chavez, he's, you know. I'm not sure that he's very Indian Chavez, and he certainly does not behave like one. That
so
I agree.
There's too much doubtful generalization here.
Too much what?
Doubtful generalization.
13,000 years that these Indians, former Siberians, would never change, while Persians changed in 2,000 years. Greeks changed even more dramatically in 2,000 years.
All I can tell you is that this is a result of 56,000 tests. What do you want me to do? This is what they tell me, not what I tell them. So, and there are averages. You see, if you look at Belgium, half of these people were French Belgians, Walloons, and the other half are Flemish. And, you know, they come in this medium position. That's the result of the testing, not opinions. Although I agree with most of some of the things surprised me a little. But, you know, you have to generalize. Russians are not Japanese. No matter what you say, Russians are not Japanese. And they don't behave like Japanese. But we have to be careful about theories, I think. I agree. Yeah.
You see, the problem, Richard, I think the problem is that there are many sociologists in the room.
Many
sociologists. And until we see how the data was collected, how the interviews were taken.
That's right.
Basically, the number of 56,000 tells nothing. It might be 56,000 false interviews, you know.
Yeah.
So the story here, on the other ground, if this triangular generalization is working practically in your practice, that's another story. And that's what we want to see, how it's working in terms of consulting. Because when I look at that, I say, well, listen, the lower left corner is Protestant, the upper corner is Catholic, and then you put the rest of the world into reactive category. And it's really a coarse generalization, and I haven't seen the interviews, but we're not going to go right now into evaluating these results academically. Tell us how it's working practically. Maybe, yeah. And then we'll see how the thing is working.
Well, for instance, most people are pretty clear about what linear people are like. They're pretty clear, you know. They're the people who come to their offices in the morning from 9 till 5. They follow their daily diagram.
But this is Protestantism, pure and simple.
Mainly. You're quite right. But then again, then we can say that linear active people are largely Protestant, and that is true. You know, there are variations in this country, but you can't get away from the fact that we test so many people. Now, if we look at Hofstede and ourselves, Hofstede did a very well-known test, as you know, 40 years ago. But the weaknesses of that is that, one, it was 40 years ago. Two, they were all male. Three, they were all on an MBA course. And four, they were all with IBM. So if we look at samples, that was a very tiny sliver of humanity. What we test is anybody who comes to us all over the world. So that we are here, we have engineers, we have young people, we have men, we have women, and ultimately you come to an average number. And then we advise companies that this person, you know, for instance, if you sent this person to work in Brazil, he would go crazy. Because he's so linear that he couldn't possibly say. We had an Englishman once in this area who wanted to work in China. And everything he said in his answers was contrary to Chinese belief. So he said all decisions in business should be made individually, not collectively. You know, decisions must be quick. And everything he said was the opposite of what Chinese believed. And he wanted to go to China to manage the Rover car company. And we had to stop him going. And of course, his own HR department knew that he was not suitable. But they needed a corroboration, of course. Yeah. Anyway, let's go on, because we have plenty of time for questions.
Let's move on.
You know, we can be here a long time. It doesn't matter. So, okay, now we have areas of cross-cultural misunderstanding. And they are largely in the areas of communication and values. Values are stronger, of course. You can get used to different styles of communication, but values are difficult to change. So you take a very simple value like punctuality, which country is most punctual in the world? Germany. Normally we would say Germans. They like to come before the meeting begins and so on. If you look at people who are not very punctual, you could say the Italians. Well, I may be generalizing, but you know, Germans are more punctual than Italians. And then if you have Germans and Italians working together, those very values cause problems. Tremendous irritation. And I worked in companies where, in a radio company, a radio house, where we had Italian announcers, German announcers, British announcers, and values. But think of values like truth, you know, the concept of truth. Some people have a very, very scientific concept of truth. You know, 2 + 2 = 4, and that's that. Whereas some people will, you ask a French person, and he says, well, you know, it depends whether it makes 4 or not. You know, I ask a French person, 2 and 2 + 4, he says, what do you mean? Suppose you have 2 cows and 2 horses, then what do you have, you see? And Chinese will tell you there is no absolute truth. Everything is contextual. And I think the Russians also think in terms of contextual truth. Sometimes it might be good and sometimes it might be bad according to the circumstances. So values can cause problems and do every day in international business. And then communication styles also. So that you have some people who talk a lot in order to express themselves and others who talk the minimum, like Finland. In Finland you only say what is necessary to say in a business situation or in a social situation, whereas in Italy you want to tell people as much as possible as long as they are willing to listen. And then you must decide where is Russia in that area. Okay, so you know, communication. And communication includes body language. Do you speak loud? Do you speak quietly? Do you demonstrate with your hands and shoulders and so on? Human mental programming. All right, now, we said that you go into this cloud and you go into it with your parents and they are your first teachers. So your parents tell you the age of 1 or when you begin to understand, that's good, that's all right, good boy, bad boy, and so on. So they are your first teachers. And the child, of course, normally obeys. And the next teacher, who is the next teacher? After the parents.
School teacher.
Pardon?
School teachers of France.
Yeah, kindergarten. You know, the kindergarten teacher corroborates what the parents told the little boy. And he's pleased to see that, to say the same thing. And all the other little children, if they're all from St. Petersburg, have had the same kind of advice. And then you get into the high school, where again all the children seem to behave the same way. And a child who behaves differently from other children, especially at the age of, from let's say 5 to 12 or 5 to 16, they become very unpopular because you're supposed to behave like everybody else. So it's a reinforcing, a self-reinforcing thing, backed by parents, kindergarten teachers, school teachers, your peers, your teachers in school and perhaps university, and certainly when you join a company, the company ask you to, you know, the IBM probably you would say is a typical American company with American values. The only exception to that is where you now are, that in a university you tend to be taught in a freer way and therefore you're allowed to, you know, experiment more. But apart from that, you're surrounded by advice. So it produces a certain, you know, nationality and a behavior for a nationality. Now, are there any universal qualities? Let's say that Germans are punctual, Spaniards are not punctual. Okay, that's a value. Now, are there any qualities which are universal and everybody's the same? And if so, what are they?
Reproduction.
Sorry?
Reproduction.
Well, yes, but that's not a quality, that's automatic. Now, of course, I mean, we all live, we all breathe, we can all see with our eyes and so on, but think about a quality, a characteristic. You know, are there any where you can see in every country people believe the same thing in this area? I'll give you one to start with. Do Russians love their children? Yes. Do Chinese love their children? Yes. Everybody loves their children. Every nationality loves children. That is a human, universal quality. Nobody tells you to love the children. You may not like next door children, but you like your own children. Now, any more? That's only one. Do you want to be liked? Do you want people to like you?
Some people, yes.
Yeah, you want to be liked. Hands up if you want to be liked. If you don't put your hands up, I'll ask you if you don't want to be liked. All right, hands up if you don't want to be liked. You see? So you want to be liked. Now this is a human characteristic. Everybody wants to be liked. They want to be popular. Some a bit more than others, but in general, people love children and they want to be liked. Tell me more. Yes.
There's a famous song of Sting. You know Sting?
Sorry?
Sting, the songwriter and famous artist.
Yeah.
There is a famous song, Do the Russians Love Their Children Too? Do you know this song?
Yeah. It's
and,
good.
He's singing about in a period of Cold War.
Yeah. Well,
and he's discussing about
that's very good.
That's
the right thing to sing is Cold War. Yeah. The Russians love their children.
Mr. Reagan and Mr. Brezhnev.
Yeah.
Disputing between two presidents.
Well, yeah, but the Russians love their children, and even the Americans love their children, and they are always very well behaved. Okay, we love children. We want to be liked. What else is universal?
We are afraid to die.
Afraid to die, yeah, well that's not a quality. It's not a characteristic you cultivate. I mean, there's many things you can say, we all breathe, you know. Well, there are about five, you know. For instance, we all are grateful for favors. So if someone helps you, you are grateful. You are walking along St. Petersburg, the Nevsky Prospect, and it's raining. And this young man comes along with his car and says, hey, jump in. You know, are you grateful or not? You know, so sooner or later you want to do something for him. And so we are all grateful for favors. And the opposite is the case. We are all angry if we see injustice. So if you see a big boy hitting a little boy, I'm not talking about courts, I'm talking about in life, a big boy hitting a little boy, it's not fair because he's bigger than that one. So in any nationality is angry if they see that kind of injustice. So we have four things, you know. All nationalities love their children. All nationalities want to be liked. All nationalities are grateful for favors. And all are angry when they see injustice. And there are not many more qualities which are completely universal. And of course psychologists, I think, would back me up in those things. They are universal qualities. Where did they come from? Are they new? They're not, they're old. And again, you have to get together the anthropologists and the psychologists and the scientists and the archaeologists, and they can tell you a lot about people, how they behaved 100,000 years ago, or even before that. The combination of science deduce a lot about the behavior, and these qualities are very old. Now, what do they have in common, these four qualities? Love of children, want affection, grateful for help, and anger. What? How would you describe those qualities? One adjective. Well, they are. Yes, it is part of biology. But what kind of qualities are they? Are they bad ones?
They're very good for being.
Yeah. Well, they're positive. They're positive qualities. Surely, you know, love of children is positive. Gratitude is positive. Sense of justice is positive. So we all have, to begin with, these lovely basic qualities, human qualities. It's after that that the trouble starts. If we only had those four qualities, all cultures would be happy working with each other. But what happens is that once you get beyond that, each country starts imposing its national culture. And while there are no good cultures and no bad cultures, what there are, different cultures. Therefore, when you arrive in a culture which is very different from your own, you are uncomfortable and you have misunderstandings. And that's what cross-culture is about. So, you know, and you never know what the problem is until you experience it. I mean, I used to employ Italians in Scandinavia, and sometimes in Sweden. And you know, Sweden is a very well-regulated country, very disciplined country, rather high standard of living, everything is quite peaceful and organized. And I used to employ Italians in some cases. And a lot of Italians, when they go to Sweden, they, of course it's very different, but they settle down, and after a couple of months I would ask one of my teachers, how do you like Sweden? He said, well, yeah, okay, you know. I said, well, what do you mean, okay? isn't it a really nice country to live in? It is, he said. It's nice and safe, and the food's all right, and it's... But I'm bored. I'm bored. In Italy, things are more chaotic, you know. I like chaos, you know. And this actually, most Italians, until they get really used to the country, they will tell you that in Sweden they get bored. There's nothing wrong with Swedish culture in a sense, but it's different, so they don't understand it. They like chaos. You send a Swede to Italy and you get the opposite. Everything's so chaotic. The post doesn't arrive. The trains are all late. Sometimes the trains don't come. Send for a taxi, he says, yes, I'm coming, doesn't come. You wait for him an hour. What kind of country is this? You know, they change the government every 3 weeks. Berlusconi would never be the Prime Minister of Sweden. So again, it's a different culture. Yeah. All right. So then what happens is you get this, that you get the basis, which the Germans all have and which you have, but these are the German qualities which you may or may not have. Serious, organized, introvert, private, thoroughgründlich, Ordnung, the most important word in Germany, Ordnung. Everything must be in order, right? Okay, we like to be tidy in England too, but not so tidy as that. You know, they're always straightening things, you know, keep that straight like that. This is Ordnung, and those pencils, put them in a nice line. So, but Germany, it's not only Ordnung by keeping things nice on the table, but Ordnung in behavior. And the way they think, you have to think in an orderly way, you see? So Germany has these particular qualities of Ordnung, and of course they are very time dominated and so on. But there are many qualities, you can't put them all in one there. Italy, very different. Here they are talkative, communicative, charming, charismatic, brilliant improvisers, because they don't plan very well, people-oriented, emotional, don't like laws, embroider the truth, and idealize the family. Quite different from the linear active German. And then you have the, we've gone the wrong way there. Then you have the Japanese, the reactive, and again, very polite, no losing face, distrust people who talk too much, search for harmony, likes to be in a group, comfortable in hierarchy. Now, if you work for a company with 100 people, are you happy if you are number one? Well, perhaps you are, but are you happy if you are number 99? Would you rather be number 81 or 56? Yeah, you know. Anyway, the thing is, in Japan, you're always happy with your rank. You're comfortable in a hierarchy. And a Japanese is uncomfortable if there is someone exactly equal. They are so imbued with hierarchy that I am number 9 and I do what number 8 tells me to do. But I tell number 10 what he has to do. This is a very, very strong feeling in Japan. And when you worked in a Japanese company, as I did in some cases, you know exactly which number you are. And you know who you have to talk up to and who you talk down to. And it's only when you meet someone new from another company, you don't know their rank. So what's the first thing they do in Japan? The visiting cards. You must have one. And you look at it carefully, and you try to decide if he or she is superior or inferior to you. These are very practical things, I'm telling you. But they are important. Japanese, yeah, well, serious, shy, ultra honest. Like to think so. How do we acquire cross-cultural competence? This is what we all are trying to do. Businessmen and women all over the world are trying to acquire this. And they take courses, university courses and private courses. You know, how do you do it? Well, there are certain things you have to do. And the first thing is you have to know your own culture. You know, do you know what Russians are like? Do you really know what Russians are like? Are you Russian? In general, yeah, what you do in general. But, you know, when you go abroad and you start seeing how other people are different, you realize that you also are different from them. And it's only when you start comparing things that you see the reality. When I was growing up in England, if you compared me with other English boys, I was fairly talkative. not very talkative, but fairly talkative. When I went to France at the age of 16, the first time I went abroad, when I lived, I'd been in France for 1 week, I was the most quiet person in the room, in nearly every room. And I became a quiet person because I was surrounded by friends. They talk all the time, so what can you do, you know? You begin to listen. So you only know your own qualities when you start comparing other people with other people. So for instance, are you a polite person? Yeah, I think you are. Russians are very polite. They have very good manners. They have better manners than, for instance, Americans in general. Now if you go to Japan, first time you go, you will be considered rude, impolite. Why? Because you're not impolite. You're not impolite. Because Japanese are so polite and ultra polite that all people in other countries seem rude because they don't reach the Japanese standards of politeness. Americans think that all other people are slow. And Americans want to do everything so fast, you know. Like Finns, for instance, think a lot of people are not honest because they're not like the Finns. So depending on your own standards, you judge other people by your standards, and you may find that they're too fast, or too slow, or too loud, or too quiet, or for one reason, you know, not honest. So culture is a very comparative thing. Are you trying to tell me to have a break? Oh, I thought you were giving me a sign. All right. Tell me when you want to break. Yes?
According to which country standards have you...
Let me come and hear what you're saying. What is what?
The pyramid that you showed us, according to which country standards is it built? Is it English culture or...
What?
You're polite when you say polite.
Polite.
What kind of polite is it?
Well,
is it English
politeness, you know, there is
Japanese
an average
politeness?
In the world. You know, there's an average in the world. I would say the average, I'm only just picking a country, but I would say the British on an average are average. On an average are polite.
So the diagram is built according to general
when you
average
go,
understanding.
Yeah, it's all relative. When you go to Asia, you notice that the most polite people are the Japanese because they bow. They treat you in a very polite way. Chinese are not quite so polite, but they are still polite, but not quite so polite. They come in more direct. And Koreans, again, are like the Chinese. And then you come down, Indians are polite. Then you get to countries, the linear countries tend to be more direct, and therefore they are not so polite. So if I am being very linear, and he says to me, "How do you like my tie?" And I'd say, "Well, I don't like it. I prefer the one you had yesterday." Now, an Australian would say that without hesitation. But I mean, a Japanese would never say, "I don't like your tie." Japanese would, "Oh, very nice tie, you know. Very nice. I wish I had a tie like that, you know." So in Japan, there's such a thing as an average. There's such a thing as average speed. The people work. Americans work very fast, you know. Finns work, well, quite fast. Spaniards work more slowly. And then there are individuals as well, of course. There are rude English people and polite English people. So you've got to know your own culture. And then, you know, what am I like as a Russian? You only find out really when you go abroad, unless someone tells you. So I could come to Russia, and if I stay here a few weeks, I will then start saying to people, "Well, actually, you're like this and you're like that because I can see you from the outside." And if you go to England, you would start seeing English people from the outside, and you will be able to tell the English people, "You are like this and you are like that." But it's hard to know your own culture, but you have to do it. And then secondly, you have to know the basics of the target culture. So you are going to work in Indonesia, you have to learn the basics. And that would mean reading about Indonesia and then getting training in how the Indonesian culture functions and identify the areas of potential conflicts. So, you know, Italians looking at Germany and seeing, you know, how exact and disciplined they are would see an area of potential conflict. So how do I combat that? You know, the Germans are not going to be happy with me because I'm much more free and easy, you know, than they are. And so therefore you have to take steps to deal with that. So it's logical. But you have to know your own culture as well as the culture you are studying. Now let's look at some differences of aspect of cultural activity. How about, is it communication first? Yeah. Now, as I said, people communicate differently. So let's take two extremes. people who talk a lot and people who talk very little. How do they get on together? Right? So, let's start off by the most talkative people in Europe, who are the Italians. And the least talkative people in Europe, who are the Finns. Have you ever been to Finland? The men say nothing. Women talk, but men say nothing. So, of course, I'm exaggerating, but not very much. Finnish men are very quiet. Imagine a business meeting where the Italian and the Finn are talking about a little venture they are going to do. And the Italian says, let me discuss the project. And he talks for 20 minutes, 5,000 words. It's a nice speech. Yeah? Finns don't like 5,000 words. Finnish men get uncomfortable if you speak to them for 20, 25 minutes without stopping. Right? So, by the time he's spoken for half an hour, the Finn says, excuse me, stop. I'm getting lost. And I've seen this happen many times. I'm getting lost. Giovanni, can you please explain what you mean? Because you said so many things, I don't know what you mean anymore. So Giovanni then, very happy, explains in 10,000 words what he said in the 5,000 words. And the Finn, of course, is in some trouble. Now, a Finn would never behave like that. We're looking at big differences in culture. And although they're both Western European cultures, there's a huge difference in the communication style of Finns and Italians. So then if you look how the Finn would open the meeting, if he had been the one, and I say he because Finnish women are rather different, a Finn would say the same description of the project in 500 words, which is all that is necessary. And because, and it takes only 3 minutes, or 5 minutes, because Italians don't always listen for the first 3 minutes, the Italian would have a problem of comprehension, like the Finn had, for the opposite reason. And he says to me, Pekka, I don't know really what you mean, will you please explain? Now, a Finn, a man, does not use 10,000 words to explain what he meant. The Finnish man uses 10,000 words in a lifetime. It's maybe a few more. So Finnish men do not believe in using words. And I've lived in Finland many years and I've seen this happen. They don't like to talk too much. So he will, in order to explain to the Italian what he meant, he will summarize and he will say something like, what I really meant is A, B, and C. The Italian is listening, you know, A, B, C. He's waiting for the rest of the alphabet. And the Finn sits down because he's finished. Now, this is very bad communication, but they are extreme styles. Now, you may say to me, Mr. Lewis, you are exaggerating. We don't believe it's like that. But this happens every day of the week. Where? And I get reports on it regularly from Finns. Where does this happen every day? Brussels. In Brussels you have the committees meeting and there will be Finns and Italians on them, and I get, of course, a lot of feedback from Finnish ministries because I trained the Finnish ministries to go to Brussels in the first place. And they say that this happens every day, that they can sit there in 2 or 3 hours and all the talking is done by the Italians and the Spaniards and the French and the Portuguese and the Greeks. And Danes manage to get in a few words and speak sometimes, but Finns very little. And they very often come back and say, I sat there for 2 days and, you know, I never said a thing. I attended the meeting, I never said a thing. So they are communication problems. It doesn't mean that they don't function. You know, they are allowed to vote, but they are, it's a communication difficulty. And these arise in business meetings all over the world. Yeah. And then, of course, these are extreme styles. I mean, Germany is in the middle. They like the idea of an agenda. So, you know, and with Germany, you must begin with the statement of the context, the past history of the project. And then you come forward to the present and explain things carefully. And then when you've examined all the facts, you make a proposal. And if they object, you absorb the counter-argument and you offer a new proposal. And this continues according to an agenda. Now some people, again in business, you know, I meet many business people, they tell me Germans are difficult to negotiate with. In fact, it's not really true. Germans are rather heavy to discuss matters with. They're not charismatic like Italians, but you always know where a German is going. You see? He's going forward. Proposal, counter-proposal. And that, for British people, is not too difficult, but they are rather heavy. France is another matter. You go to a French business meeting and they state their position in a rather verbose way, like the Italian. And if you object to it, they restate their position. Because French people don't like to give in. They can be rather obstinate, and it's a well-known factor in French business that they do not change opinion very easily. Therefore, you have to work very hard in negotiating with French. And if you resist, they then use a lot of words, which is a little bit like the Italian style, using a lot of words. But the French usually reinforce their arguments with logic, so they are very difficult to beat. So you see, there are different communication styles, and you have to know how to deal with that. You know, how do you deal with French negotiators? They don't give in. You want to negotiate, they keep their position. You know, how do you deal with that? These are things you have to learn. With a German, if you prove you're right, the German says, yes, you prove you're right. French person, you've got to be very good to prove you're right. See? And then you have USA, where they put all the cards on the table. And if you object, they spell it all out again in louder English. You know? Americans kind of, you know, think we spell it out again, you'll understand. And then they can provoke and they can fight with words, and they can be very rough in meetings, which doesn't suit some very formal negotiators like French and Germans. The British, we have a very special style, and that's what we call don't rock the boat. So here you see, don't upset anybody. Keep it nice and civilized. So, 5 minutes, cup of tea, casually introduce the proposal, our proposal, it's reasonable, and they resist. So then what do? We keep calm, we understate, we say we seem to have a little problem, and we use coded speech, and we use humor and so on. Now coded speech, I don't know if you know this, but coded speech is when you say the opposite of what you mean in order not to upset them. So imagine if you have a German in your meeting and he puts an idea on the table which is not a very good idea. Let's say it's a stupid idea. What would another German say if he sees a stupid idea? What does he say? Germans are direct. They say that's a stupid idea. It's a stupid idea. Yeah. Now, an Englishman would never say that. I don't know what a Russian would say, but an Englishman would never say that's a stupid idea. What does he say? I'm sure you can guess.
I'm afraid this is not exactly what we wanted to see.
I'm afraid that's not exactly what I had imagined. Or he might simply say,
let's have a look at it from the other side.
Yeah. Or he can simply say, interesting idea, Helmut. And Helmut thinks he said it's interesting, you see? So this is how we use coded speech in England. So, and I've seen this happen where a man called Helmut put a stupid idea on the table for a British company to change advertising from 25% television to 75% television. And the British chairman thought it was very stupid, and he said to him, this is real life, Helmut, interesting idea. Which means, of course, what a stupid suggestion. But we don't say that. That's what an Australian would say, or a German. We say that. So Helmut, and this is a real case, he said to me, can we talk about it more? And the Englishman said, Helmut, we must have a meeting about your idea. Helmut said, already in the meeting? Yes, he said, but we must have a meeting about your idea. Maud, make a note, we must have a meeting. And so Helmut said, well, does that mean we can do it? Go ahead with it. And the English chairman looked him in the eye and he said, Helmut, we shall certainly consider it. Which means, in English, we won't do it. And this real man, whom I know, he went back to his... It was from the company Adidas. It's a real company. He went back to Adidas in Germany and he said, they found my idea was interesting and they're going to have a meeting about it and they're considering going ahead with it. That's what he heard. But what he should have heard was, it's a stupid suggestion and forget it or we won't do it. So that's something you have to deal with when you're communicating with English people. And the interesting thing is that we are not trying to deceive you. It's only we don't want to upset you. So if you put a stupid idea on the table, we don't want to tell everybody that you're stupid. So we just say, well, you can think about it, I suppose. Yeah. And so this goes on in English meetings all the time. And English people do it to each other. But English people understand what's being done. So if I am at a meeting and I put an idea on the table and the chairman says to me, interesting, Richard, I know that it's finished. If we go on to the next thing. Or if he says, oh, another meeting about that. Or if he says, I'll call you, that means I won't call you, you see. So it's a way of speaking, and it's limited only to Britain. Although, in some cases, like New Zealand, they can be rather similar. Australians are completely different. Americans are completely different. They are direct. I don't like it. Forget it, you know. It won't work. But that's what you do. So the ones of you who go to England, and I know many young foreign people who go to England to work for a while, bear in mind that this will happen to you. And it usually takes about 3 months before you get used to it. And then you know whether I mean, interesting, or if I mean, interesting. You see? It's very often tone of voice. Here are some more examples. See? So, for instance, here. When a British boss says, let me make a suggestion, what he really means is, this is what I've decided to do. Have you ever heard English people say, correct me if I'm wrong? Have you heard that expression? You know, he comes into the room and says, correct me if I'm wrong. Whatever you do, don't correct him. What he really means is, don't correct me because I'm right. Yeah, so he says, correct me if I'm wrong, and then he tells you what he wants. Yeah. So these are, Are you all right without a pause? It's up to you. I carry on like this till 5:30, no problem. If you need a 5-minute break, just say so. What do you think, Director?
Well, we can stop in 15 minutes for 10 minutes.
In 15 minutes, we stop for 10 minutes. Okay. All right. We'll go on. Don't hesitate to ask questions whenever you want. That's why I'm here. Listening
habit. All the Germans say stupid in German.
All the Germans say stupid. Dumme, they say dumme. Das ist eine ganze dumme Idee.
In such a direct way.
And the Germans have no hesitation in saying that. It's good to criticize in German. It's good, you know. You put things right by criticizing. But in England, no. We're not like that. And I think Russians will be more delicate. Huh? Russians are not so direct. Now, listening habits. Just as all people communicate in different ways, people listen in different ways. And you are listening like Russians. Did you know that? You're listening like Russians. You're not listening like Americans. You're better listeners than Americans. I've come to the conclusion after 2 or 3 days in Russia that Russians are good listeners because you listen and then you make intelligent comments and you don't interrupt. So you are good listeners. But let me show you a few habits, how it varies. Americans are not very good listeners. Now, the reason why is that they are used to Hollywood and American television. And they like entertainment. Americans like it. They are people who need to be entertained. Not all the time, but to the beginning of an American meeting, you have to crack a joke of some kind. You come into the room and you say something funny. And now, why do you do that? Because if you start giving them statistics, if it's a business meeting, and you give them statistics on why this product is, they get bored. You came all the way from Russia and you start giving them statistics. Oh dear me, you know. Or all the way from Germany, even worse, more statistics. Americans only listen in snatches. That means they listen 5, 10, 15 minutes at a time. Then they don't listen anymore because they like entertainment. Of course they are serious about business, but you must entertain them at the beginning. So you must start a meeting with something amusing. And it's imperative. Now, I can give you some examples. Well, I mean, I once worked 6 months in New York in an American office, and every day the boss came in and he said something funny, and then we all started work. Now, let me give you an example of what happens when you're mixing with Germans in this respect. In 1999, I think, I went to America with a German delegation from the Dornier company, and they were selling missiles to the Americans, and it was a good business. But they were 19 men, all middle-aged, all Bavarian, almost wearing lederhosen, you know, typical Bavarian middle-aged men, cross-culturally not very successful, and spoke some English, but not too much. So I had to, they asked me to go to America to facilitate and mediate and sometimes translate at the meeting, which I did. And when we, and it was in Atlantic City. And when we got to Atlantic City, the first morning, we got together in a room about this size, and I was sitting in the corner because I was only mediating, and the American host, who was a young man of about 35, he did what all Americans do. He opened the meeting with a joke. And what he said was, to all these Germans, all engineers, he said, good afternoon, gentlemen, let me welcome you to Atlantic City. I'm sorry I had to make this conference in Atlantic City, because as you probably know, Atlantic City is a very boring place. Which it is, by the way. He said, it's so boring that last Wednesday night, when the tide went out, it didn't come back on Thursday morning. The Germans all looked at him, you know. You know, the tide, the water, the tide. The tide went out last Wednesday night, and it didn't come back on Thursday morning. Well, I knew what effect this would have on the Germans, because in Germany, you don't make jokes in business meetings. So all the 19 heads turned around and looked at me, and I tried to hide, you know. And then the American went on, thinking that he told his joke, and, you know, that was fine. Because Americans tell a joke to get your attention for 20 minutes. Because maybe you tell another joke in 20 minutes, so they will listen for 20 minutes. So I knew what was going to happen, and at the first coffee break, chief German engineer came over to me and he said, Herr Lewis, what did he mean when he said the tide did not come back on Thursday morning? In Germany, the tide always comes back. I said, well, it does in America too, you know. The tide does come back in America. Then why did he say the tide didn't come back? I said, American humor. He said, what? I said, American humor. Ah, he said, American humor. So then he went back to his group and he said, it was American humor. So here you have two people living in different worlds, you know. I mean, the Americans were very serious about the business, but they approached the business in a rather relaxed manner, and the Germans, they were engineers, you know. If the tide goes out, by the laws of physics, it must come back, you know. In Germany, it always comes back. So, but they didn't quite understand that humor was part of the business process, you see. So that's a deep cultural difference. Even though they were all engineers talking about the same, you know, products and so on. So this is listening habit. And then once you've told your joke to an American audience, then they're very business oriented. And then it's simply, what's new, get to the point, give me facts and figures, keep it simple. Americans like things simple, you know. If you're going to sell it hard. And what's the bottom line? Very business oriented listening. But first you have to soften them. And then every 20 minutes or so, you have to tell them another joke. Germany, very different listening habit. Germany, you have to give them the past history of the thing before they understand why you're doing this, you see. We're going to open a factory making ice cream in Chile. Ah, Americans would say, we are? Great, love the climate, let's go. German says, they're going to Chile? Why are they going to Chile to make the ice cream factory? Why Chile? Well, you know, we think it's a good idea. Has it been done before? Where in Chile? Santiago. Has it been done before? If so, was it a success or not? Why are we going to Chile? Why are we not going to Argentina? So German wants the, you know, the context, and which is fair enough. So, and then, you know, then they begin to listen when you've explained the context, but they take things literally. So like he said, the tide didn't come back, they take it literally. They don't think it's symbolic. And no jokes, please, because we're German. And no hard sell, because we want soft sell. And what does it cost, because we're cost conscious. And does this sound too simple? Life is not simple, you know. This sounds too simple. I don't think we can make money so easily. And what happens if? So a cautious listening pattern, where the Americans had a relaxed, you know, humorous listening pattern. Every country listens differently. They don't only talk differently, they listen. France, difficult audience. Why? Because French people think they know already what you're going to tell them. I lecture in France, and I find them much more difficult than German audiences or Spanish audiences, because they think that French people think they know most things. You are only English, you are only Russian, what can you tell a French? No? Now, I'm not anti-French, but this is the way they are. French people have a sense of intellectual superiority, which is not, of course, quite true, but they think that way. So the only way you can hook a French audience is to tell them something they don't know at the beginning, and then they listen, you see, because of course they want to learn. And French is best, so it's very hard to sell to them. UK, we're rather good listeners, you know. We expect humor. We like a low-key speaker. We're prepared to make a debate with you afterwards. And we give good feedback. So in England, at the end of the speech, we give feedback. And we're polite. We're not bad listeners. Okay. Well, the problem with French listening is that they don't listen. All right. UK, we've done that already, haven't we? Rather good listeners, leadership style. Yeah. You know, about Finland, they are very good listeners, but in Finland, there is one, you don't need to tell a joke in Finland, but you have to, in order to get a Finnish audience for 1 hour, what must you do? You buy 1 hour of Finnish listening time. You buy it with a cup of coffee. So Finns say, before we start, kuppikahvia. And then if they get the kuppikahvia, then they listen for 1 hour. And if you speak more than 1 hour, milloin me saamme syövää kuppikahvia. They want to know when to get the next cup of coffee. So in Finland, it's very easy to collect your audience. Leadership styles. Well, you know, leaders, business, different countries, it's different. Sweden has the most democratic leadership in the world. The manager sits with the staff. He doesn't sit in a separate room. He sits with the staff for any important discussion. He may have a private office, but the door must be open. And he always sits with the staff if there's anything important going on. And all staff give their impressions or opinions before they make a decision. So Sweden is consensus-minded, very similar to Japan, where you must make a decision. The opposite of that is France, which is autocratic, and the président directeur général, the boss, he decides everything and sends the orders downwards. And you obey the man in front of you, or on top of you, or woman. In Germany, it's almost the same, autocratic, but German workers are very educated and they also consider what the factory floor says. There's not much difference. USA, any American manager will tell you, I am individualistic, I make decisions standing on my feet, and so on. And they do in Europe, but they have very strict reporting systems. So he makes an individual decision, but then he has to report to the country manager, who reports to the head office in Chicago, and they are very, very strict with that. So Americans are not as individualistic as they seem, not in corporate life. No? In the UK, we're a bit like the Swedes, we have a circle. The managers, so it's a little bit outside the circle. And it's sometimes in England, the class difference, especially in the city. So you see, leadership is different in different countries. China, it's a leadership group always. And there you have government interference, and you also have provincial interference. So in China, the mayor of Shanghai influences anything that's happening in Shanghai. They are becoming more capitalist now, as is the Chinese tradition. It's family businesses. And they are beginning that again. Concepts of time. Well, again, this is very much, you know, the linear people versus the rest. The linear people, they have a diary. In the diary, it says, I start at 9 o'clock and I do these things. So their diary looks a bit like this, you know? So the German or the American start here and they do A before they start B. And when they finish A, they do B. And they work like that. Whereas the Japanese and the Italians and the multi-active and reactive put these six tasks in a pool. And they walk around the pool and for a while they do nothing. And then they start doing certain things. So these they do, those they don't do. That's a new idea. So it's a more flexible. Management needs this style. If you're discussing strategy, you can't do it like that. But of course, a lot of linear active people try to do things step by step. So multi-active people. I think Russians would be more in this area, thinking about it and trying to get a holistic approach. And then besides time, you have space. Now, concept of space is quite important, and we don't always realize it. So that we all have personal space, and we don't like people coming in our personal space, but personal space in each country is different. So when I'm giving this lecture, are you comfortable? You didn't sound very enthusiastic. Well, I invaded this personal space, because I presume in Russia it's about 1 liter. So if I invade your personal space, I'm not talking to you, I'm talking to them, but you're not comfortable because I'm in your meter, personal space. You know, leave it, please. And that's okay, I will leave it. But the funny thing is that in some countries, each country is different. And psychologists, again, have measured personal space in each country. And it's fixed. So in England it's 1.2 meters. And I can't remember the Russian, but I suspect it's about 1 meter. Russians stand closer to each other and sit closer to each other than British people. Americans are about the same as the British. Italians are very, very comfortable standing or sitting next to each other. Italians love this kind of thing. Hello, how are you? Okay. I've seen my pictures, look at this. So, of course, personal space, you can show a picture, it's no problem. But if I start talking business with her, then it has to change. So I'm showing you a picture. You're the manager of a factory which is selling me something. I'm showing you this picture, isn't it nice? And you're looking and say, yes. And I say, can you give me a discount of 10%? And immediately she wants me here. Because personal space is one thing, but business is 1.2 meters. So you can't, you've got to give people plenty of room if you're discussing business. Different from showing photographs. Now, this is very national. And I show you two or three pictures. The picture is a bus queue. Now this is a bus queue in a Latin country. Now Latins like to be close to people, especially Italy, Mexico, and so on. So this bus queue, you see, they're all standing close to each other. And very often the shoulders are touching. And there's no friction, because they're all happy like that. Now maybe you Russians are like, I mean, you're sitting very close to each other here, and everybody looks like they're very close to each other there. But you look comfortable. So maybe in Russia, you see, that's okay. And they are very friendly. It's in Portugal, all Latins, all with the boss. Now in some countries, they don't feel like that. That would be impossible in some countries. For instance, in this country, they feel like that. But that's very different from the other boss here. And last year I was in Brazil, in São Paulo, and I took this picture and I showed it in São Paulo. And they said, what are those people doing? I said, well, the bus queue. No, they said, no, it's not a bus queue. Yes, it's a bus queue. But if it's a bus queue, where is the bus?
Here.
Why is a woman not standing next to the bus? Well, in this country, you allow 15 meters. You are first, and then 5 meters, and then two. That's how they queue. Don't ask me why. That's how they queue. They said, well, the funny people, strange people. He said, in Brazil, we like the other picture you showed us. That's how we queue. And in Brazil, we talk to each other when we're waiting for the bus. But these people are not talking to each other, because this man is looking over there and he's looking over there. So these people are not talking to each other. They are strange people. If I said to Brazilians, well, they are a bit strange. And they said, well, in Brazil, if you take a picture of a bus queue, everybody looks at the camera and there's this. And I say, well, in this country, if you take a picture of a bus queue without asking their permission, they do this. Well, everybody says, well, you know, they're very strange people. They queue up, but they don't stand in the bus stop. They allow big spaces. They don't talk to each other. You take the picture and they don't look at the camera. They're very strange people. But they say, well, one thing or not, they are very honest people. And I said, well, yes, they are honest people. How do you know? They said, well, in São Paulo, if you leave that black bag there, so that's what the Brazilians see. They don't see a bus queue. They see a bag standing alone and no one is taking it. So that's how they see, that's what they see in the picture. They don't see a bus queue. So then they said to me, well, Mr. Lewis, we think that you fix people. We don't believe that anybody can queue like that. We think that you told them to stand like that and took the picture. I said, I wouldn't do a thing like that. Of course I didn't. I said, if I show you the picture of another Finnish bus queue, and this is Finland, of course, if I show you the picture of another Finnish bus queue, where I am not anywhere near them, will you believe me? And they said, yeah. So then I showed them another picture. Did you ever see a bus queue like that before? That's a bus queue in the suburbs of Helsinki. And that's how they stand when they have room. So I said, now do you believe me? And they all said, yes, sir. And this is another bus queue where everybody's sitting down. And that's in another country, of course. And do you know which that country is? It's Cuba. So why does everybody sit down? Because the bus could come today or tomorrow. They don't know when the bus is coming. So you see, even things like that, physical things, are very cultural. Now, we come now to a rather important part, and that is life within horizons. Wherever you are born, you look at the world when you're old enough. You look out of the window, and what do you see? You are born in St. Petersburg, you see Russia. You only see a part of Russia. And so your view is a bit like this. This is a person looking out of the window, right? And you see the world. But it's a Russian world. And because you can't see very far, you only see, well, a part of St. Petersburg. But that's okay. That's your world. And in that world, you have borscht soup, and you have nice buildings and statues and churches and nice universities. That's your world. But other people see a Canadian world or a German world. And so what we have to do is compare these worlds. And you can do it with another diagram, which we use a lot when we're working, is that this is a Russian looking at a Russian world. Here's, you know, all the Russian characteristics. And this is an American looking at American world with McDonald's and, you know, President Obama and baseball and all the American things. But because Russians and Americans are not entirely different, there can be an overlap. And the overlap is here, you see. So there's the American world, there's the Russian world, but here there is a lot of overlap. So if you then fill in that, and this is UK and Russia, well, this is the English world, and it's very different from the Russian world. But because English people and Russians are not so different, you have things in common, which means you can get along together. So when we're working with companies who are going to Indonesia or Bulgaria, Swedish company, we try to make this diagram. We make it with them. We say, look, these things are going to be different. They'll always be different. But you can concentrate on this area to have good relations. So, you know, UK and Russia, a lot of people are Protestant and you're Orthodox, you're all secular. Individualism, you're more collective. We have a loose family structure, you have family closeness. We are results-oriented, you are relationship-oriented. Right? We are bad at languages, you are good at languages. We have cool discourse, you have personalized, warm discourse, conversation. We respect officialdom. Sometimes you would like to pull strings with your friends, get something done. We follow agendas closely. Russians like to digress from agendas, but they like, you know, new ideas. And we follow rules, and sometimes you do and sometimes you don't. So there are differences in the culture. And they won't go away. Probably not. But how do I get on with Russians? Well, I have a sense of humor, and Russians have a sense of humor. So we can laugh about it. I understand Russian jokes.
I don't understand any Japanese jokes. No. German jokes, well, I understand them, but I don't think they're fun. But Russian jokes, French jokes, I understand. Danish jokes are very similar to ours. So, what do we have in common? We have a sense of humour, and we are self-deprecating. That means that we can talk modestly about ourselves. An Englishman never says, I am the most intelligent person on the planet. That's what French people say. We are rather modest. We can even say, stupid old me, you know. Self-deprecating. And Russians do that too. You know, modest about their own capability. Sometimes too modest. We have good common education, both in Russia and in England. We are both inventive people. We have invented many things in our history. And we all love Shakespeare and theatre. I'm surprised. I think there's more Shakespeare performed in Russia than there is in England. Some of you. Russians have good manners, and English people have rather good manners. And in Russia and England, we don't criticise directly, like the German. We criticise indirectly. Like saying, well, yes, perhaps, you know, criticising indirectly. We like conspiracy. That happens to be, we like literature which deals with conspiracy. We have a strong sense of justice. Russian people feel they know what is right and what is wrong. Because in the old days, in the Mir, you knew, you know, never mind what the law is justice. And we have the same sense in England. You know, we don't have a written constitution. In England, we don't have, Americans have a written constitution. No. We judge things according case by case. Is it just or not? Yeah? We were allies in 20th century, twice. And Russians and English people have a lot of common sense. So you see, I am very optimistic that Russians do business with English people. Because usually it turns out quite well. And I am a member in London of the Russo-British Chamber of Commerce, and we have very good evenings, very good parties, and very good meetings. There's not a lot of, there are differences. There are differences here, but there are not so many differences. Now, you look at the Russians and the Germans, differences are many. Very, very different. There are some things in the middle, but not many. Okay, music and opera, Germans love it like music. A German enters a room unsmiling, a Russian enters a room unsmiling. You know that. When Russians come into a room, they are not smiling. Now they're all smiling, but you didn't at the beginning. Now, you go in a room in Italy and everybody's smiling all the time. Americans entering a room always put on the American smile, the Hollywood smile, yeah? Russians don't. Germans don't. So one thing you have in common in Germany is when you come into a room, you don't smile immediately. You only smile when you see a friend or if you hear something humorous, which is fair enough. A certain amount of caution. You share technical ability. Music and opera, soul searching. You are serious about the way you live your lives. And you are also rather resilient, rather strong. But the differences are enormous. Germans are very formal. It's like too much. In Germany, you know, I worked in a German office for 2 years, and all the people in the office called each other by their surnames. I knew he was Hans, but I had to call him Herr Dr. Schallmeier for 2 years. And you call them with titles and with surnames, and you don't address anybody in the office with a Christian name unless you happen to be friends outside, like if you play tennis together, then of course you do. But in an office environment, you can work for 10 years in the same office, and they all call each other by their surname. In Russia, you don't do that, do you? I think you use the patronym also, don't you? Like Vladimir Ivanovich, Ivanovich, or the son of the, yeah, patronym.
Yeah.
Which I think is quite nice. You use your father's name as a more familiar. But the Germans are very formal, and they also in meetings they're very formal. They're very time-dominant. They have a tendency to complicate. They are job-oriented, you are more people-oriented. The deal is important, the Russians, the relations are important, even in a business situation. Germans separate work and social life, Russians live. Germans value privacy, Russians are much more gregarious. Makes more easy. Facts are more important than feelings. In Russia, feelings are more important than facts. I hope. Scientific truth in Russia, a little bit of blando now and again. It helps the world go along with more. Relaxed truth. Ordnung, you never escape from that. Russians like jokes. Relaxed orderliness. And so you see, tight planning, relaxed planning, observes all rules, disregards many rules. Germans are a bit boring, Russians are more charismatic. So, if I came again tomorrow, we would talk more. And you would be charismatic. Charisma is important in Russia, it's important in Italy, it's important in France. Germans don't trust charisma. It's important in America. Dutch people don't like charisma. They want it to be serious. In England, 50-50. We like a bit of charisma. But Italy more, and so on. So you see, the differences are enormous. But when you're going to work in Germany, you have to learn these things and these things and these things. And then you act accordingly. You have to adapt to each other's culture. And of course, we've not got a lot of time, but I could do this with every country, you know. And when we're, you know, America and Russia, of course you are different. But actually quite a few things are common in America and Russia, as these gentlemen have been to America, they know. You are both great world powers. You both were pioneering countries. America conquered the West, Russia conquered Siberia. Very similar, you know, huge land acquisition, expansionist. Messianic sense of mission. What's the American sense of mission? What's the Russian sense of mission? What do you think? What do you want Russia to do in the world? American sense of mission, of course, it's well, very clear. It's to be everywhere and run the world's business. So.
No one's opinion from here.
Yes.
Yeah,
what is the Russian sense of mission? You have a mission in the world.
Well, I can only say for myself, I can't say for all the Russians.
Well, what's your mission in the world?
What's my mission in the world? I don't know, self-respect and confidence, good family.
You're so shy, I didn't hear it. But I'm sure you have a nice mission, but I didn't hear it. You have to tell me. Yeah. Tell me, go on. What's your mission? Okay, tell me tomorrow. Well, I think one of Russia's missions, you are the only country in the world who can unite, you know, east and west. You are everywhere. You know, you understand the east, you understand the west. That's what I think has been said before. One of Russia's missions is to unite people. It's a very humanistic mission, which is quite different from a lot of people's mission, which is very materialistic. The French mission is to civilize Europe, but of course, we don't always let them. The English don't let them. But here you see, the Americans have a lot in common with you. They're messianic, they of course want to conquer the world, they want trade. They think big, the Russians think big. Look at your statue, look at your building. How many big buildings you have in St. Petersburg? I don't know any city in the world with so many big buildings. They're not skyscrapers, but they're big. You know, you think big, your ships are big, your airplanes are big, your statues are big, you know, your land is big. And the Americans are a bit like that. Multi-ethnic, no aristocracy. Both countries very hospitable. Very direct and quite direct in speech. Americans more than you, but still. And of course, you involve our strong technology. So you have a lot in common with them. Although, they're enemies. So take things like individualism, the Russians are far more collective. Western European roots, you have European and Asian roots. Americans like profits, you don't like too many profits. You know? And so on. So you see, this with this diagram, we educate companies on, you know, the country they're going to. For instance, we teach Volvo. And a few years ago, we did this diagram, and we said to them, go out of the room. They were doing business with Arabs, with Saudi Arabia. So we said, well, we know there aren't any differences, but think of what you have in common with Saudi Arabians. Go out of the room, work for 10 minutes, come back. They came back after 10 minutes. What did they have in the middle? Nothing. They said, we can't think of anything we can talk to Arabs about. We can't talk about women. We can't talk about religion. You know, we can't talk about alcohol. What are we going to talk about with Arabs? You know, Swedes use these subjects normally in small talk. We don't know what small talk, because if you make small talk with people in business, you get better business. You know, you get personal relationship, and then you do better business. This is known all over the world. Russians do it, Italians do it. But with Arabs, you know, what can we talk about? You know, they, even their sports are different from ours. Now, okay, now they begin to play a bit of football, but before that, horses, we race horses, they race camels. You know, there's almost nothing to put in the middle. And we did the same exercise with a Norwegian company, and they said the only thing we have in common with Arabs is oil. Norway has oil, Arabs oil. But after that, when you talk about the business, that's okay. But after the business, in a party, how do you get closer to the Arabs? So you need these commonalities in the middle. And the more you find, you know, the easier it is to improve your business. And it's very important in business to have good relations. Now, you look at Italy and Russia, there's quite a lot in the middle. Because they are very humanistic people, like you are, eloquent, humanistic, compassionate, personalized discourse, imaginative, adaptable, flexible, truth, close families, sociable, distrust of officialdom, seek favors from friends, share details of private life. Russians like to do those things, Italians like to do those things. And actually, with Spaniards, even more things. So the Russian culture is not very different from the Spanish culture. In fact, it's very similar. So there are differences, Catholic, Orthodox, individual, collective, hierarchical, more egalitarian in Russia, you feel you're all equal. Technical ability, they don't have it in Spain, mañana, you're faster moving. But these things are common to Spain and Russia. So Russians going to Spain are making creating relations with Spaniards have an easy time, because there are many things you can talk about. You're all humanistic, you're warm-hearted, hospitality, compassionate, personal in speech, family closeness, respect for elders. Very strong in Russia, very strong in Spain. Tendency to vagueness, like to simplify, multi-active, relaxed about timekeeping, and don't like to be involved. So, I was once asked on Russian television about 5 years ago, they asked me, they were phoning in questions from Kazan and places all over Russia. And they asked me on television which culture is most similar to Russia. And I would say it's the Spanish. Not the same, different. But you have more in common with the Spaniards than you have with the Germans, or with the Dutch, or with the Norwegians. So that's how you should think about culture. What have we got in common? How can we develop it, cultivate it? Yeah? And Italy are the same, as I said. Spain, France, you have many problems, but there are things in the middle. You both had a revolution, you have a sense of mission, patriotism strong in France, tendency to grandiosity, reputation more important than profit. That's French, that's Russian. You want to make money, but you're concerned about your reputation. Very good. You both love opera and ballet, and you have very extensive mission. So you see, with every country you have commonalities, but the different commonalities in each case. So you share certain things with the British, but you share other things with the Spanish, and you share some things with the Germans. With people like the Arabs, you share very little. So it's harder to do business with the people with whom you share, not only do business, but to create general relations. China, Russia again, not an awful lot in common. So when I say things like this, it takes all kinds to make the world. So here you are looking at the international. What's your attitude? US, what do you see? Money and material. Well, the Russian attitude could be, money is not everything. That's how you should approach them. UK, we like strict agendas. You say Russian, well, we like talking about directions. It's interesting, you know? Don't worry about the agenda. Germans, formal or rule-bound. Russians say, okay, we have to be a little disciplined when we're doing what we need. That we understand. But we don't need to be so there. France, arrogant and obstinate. We need patience. And French people, we have to be patient with them. Spanish, mañana. How can we get things done? Because they are slower, much slower than Russians to do things. Italians are emotional, okay. How can we calm them down? They're too emotional for us. And Chinese introverts, what do they really think? So you see, with all those different characteristics, you have to have a different reaction. You have to think of the clever way to deal. And that's a question of studying the culture, being patient, you know. So conflicts and solutions. Well, you know, the UK, you don't have many conflicts. But, for instance, we have this individualism. You should praise individualism, but pointing out that teamwork is good too. The Russians are more collective. And results orientation, okay, you want results, but not just money. Good atmosphere is a good result. So you're showing a more humanistic view than most nationalities, you see. Love of strict agendas. Digression from agendas can lead to new exciting ideas. You know, only just one or two ideas how to deal with people. I could give you 100 rules on how to deal with British people. At least 100. But today, we haven't time if you look at different nationalities. But I'll give you one or two little points. Germany, rule-bound, point out the benefits of interpreting rules freely. You know, Russians have rules too, but you know how to interpret them. For instance, no parking, right? No parking. German says, you can't put your car here. Then an old man of 80 years of age comes along. The Russian is more likely to say, let all people park here, if they're over 75. Yeah? That's interpreting rules freely. And of course, there's a lot of that in Russia, and there's a lot of that in Spain. Germany, no, a rule is a rule. Formality. You have to be more friendly, try to make them more friendly. Poorer socializing, make them relax. They don't like jokes, tell them humor is enjoyable. You know, when they directly criticize, you say you understand that they are criticizing in order to help. You understand that they are critical, you see. Ordnung, well, all you can do is be as tidy as you can, because you will never be as orderly as the Germans. Shall I show you some pictures of German Ordnung? Would you like to see them?
Yes, sure.
Is this room orderly? Not here, not here. Put them in Ordnung, yeah? This is sure. Put those papers in Ordnung.
Strengthen the book, strengthen the
book. Okay, that's kind of German attitude. I would not say that. Now I will show you German Ordnung. Look at this. That's a German butcher shop. That picture is not possible in any country. They were having a picture taken. Look what they did with all the beef, the sausages, and everything. Perfect order, yeah? I never saw an English butcher shop like that, and I don't think you ever saw a Russian butcher shop like that. And then if you look at the fishmonger, he's the same. See all the girls there, tall one in the middle, all the fish, different fishes and all. Yeah. The big man with big fish. This is German Ordnung. You know, I once gave a lecture with another friend of mine, and we were lecturing in Germany. We entered the room before the Germans came, and there was a sign on the wall, it was in German, but I understood it, and it said, please leave this, when you leave this room, please leave it in the same order you found it when you came in. And my friend said, well, it's all right, I'm saying that, but I may not remember. And then he went to another notice, and there was a picture of the room. He said, that is how you leave it, you see. So not only did they tell you to leave it tidy, but they showed a picture of the room, so you remember how tidy it is. So this is just, it's a German characteristic, you know. We can't blame them for it. They're like that. And if things are not in Ordnung, they worry. They're special No, it's a drive for efficiency, I suppose, not a drive for ordinance. USA, individualism, well, demonstrate the benefits of collective, unselfish approach. Profit orientation, show reputation brings more satisfaction than money. You're a humanistic, that's how you have to deal with these linear people like Germany and USA and Holland. Risk-taking. Advise combining US risk-taking with sensible European caution. So all these are just little tricks you use, but of course you need, I need to talk to you all day about the Germans or the Italians. Not just one or two little points, but today all I can do is just show you one or two, you know. If the Italians are very emotional, don't be afraid to show your own emotion, because they like it. If they interrupt you, you interrupt them because they like it. But if you interrupt an Italian, it shows that you're interested in what he's saying. It shows that you're listening to what he's saying. So if you can interrupt that, but in Finland, don't interrupt. And in Germany, don't interrupt. And even in England, we don't like interruptions. But with Italians and Spaniards and French, you can interrupt all the time. Spain, well, poor language ability. You have to help them with their language when you're talking to Spaniards. Their English is very poor. And when it comes to the mañana behavior, there's only one thing you can do, and that is accept it, because they will never change. I have tried to make Spaniards change from mañana for 30 years, never succeeded. But it shows, don't try to change the culture. You can adapt to it, but don't try to change it. France, obstinacy. Show humility. When they are cynical, show sincerity. You know, then they change. They try to change when they see that you're sincere and they're being cynical, skeptical. Show that. Don't be like that. Just show sincerity. Well, we've got to do our best. And so they kind of educate them a little bit. China, sometimes they don't want to spend any money. You know, they're stingy. Thrift. Russians are generous. You know? So show them. Show generosity, and when you show them generosity, they will react very well, because if they don't, they'll lose face. So you buy the drinks, you know, never mind the Chinese are all about, you buy the drinks. But then they will reciprocate sooner or later, otherwise they lose face. So show the Russian positive qualities, don't be afraid if they're different from the other, especially when they're good ones. Now, this is an important point, and a lot of Russians don't realize this, is that the Russians have a lot of qualities. Now, of course, all nationalities have a lot of qualities. So some are more than others. It's a strange thing, but I've analyzed Russian characteristics very often, and I find that if we compare you with Western Europe, these are all Russian qualities. And you know, they are. There's no doubt about it. Russians are generous, family closeness, you respect the elderly, compassion, soul friendships, courteous manners, love of theatre and money, love of music and opera, talent for literature, technical ability, very, very technical, scientific, imagination and vision, sense of humour, eloquence, and linguistic ability. You're good at learning languages. Now, they are all European qualities, because the Europeans have them too. But a lot of the European countries don't have all those qualities. They only have some of them. You see? I'm showing the completeness of the Russian character, which even Russians sometimes don't realize. For instance, you have technical ability. You're very good at technical matters. And so are the Germans, and so are the Nordic countries. But Spaniards are not very good at technical matters. You know, so this is a thing that you can share with some countries, but not with others. Compassion, generosity. Spaniards and Italians are very generous. Other nationalities in Europe don't have that same sense of generosity. At different degrees, of course, but a Scotsman is not typified by generosity. Chinese are not European. Germans are not particularly generous. They're fair, but they're not generous. So some of the Russian qualities are mirrored in other countries, but a lot of these countries don't have a lot of these qualities. So what you have is breadth of vision. Breadth of vision. It's very important. Important for leadership. Important for making your way in the world. So that, you know, eloquence, France and Italy, they can speak eloquently like Russians can. But Finns can't. Finns don't have eloquence. They only say what's necessary. And of course, eloquence is still a positive characteristic. Linguistic ability, the Nordic countries have the same ability as you have, and so do the Dutch. But Britons don't have linguistic ability. We can't speak languages. It takes us a long time. And Spaniards are terrible at languages. And French are not very good at languages. Partly because they want to live in their own language. Whereas Russians can learn other languages. So you have linguistic ability. I'm astonished at the level of English in this room. Where will you find in England, in a university, a bunch of people who can speak Russian as well as you speak English? You can't. You might find a room where they speak reasonable French, but I would guarantee your level of English, from what I gather, is superior to a lot of other nationalities who are at the same stage in the university. So Russians can learn languages. I don't know why, but they can. So these things you have, these sense of humor. The Germans don't have much sense of humor. I would say the sense of humor strongest, closest to yours would be in Britain and Denmark and Finland. These countries have more. Northern countries seem to have more humor than others. Some people say it's because of the bad weather. So what I'm pointing out is that you have a very broad vision, and that's positive. So you're actually more complete Europeans than many other countries in Europe who are only of limited vision. And of course you have this extra advantage in that you are a bridge between East and West. And in fact, besides the European qualities, you have two or three Asian qualities. These are just three of them. Stoic in adversity, think of the war, how you suffer. You have self-sacrifice and stoicism, which are Asian qualities, more than European. And adaptability. So we come to a picture, and I've been studying this for some time, we come to a picture of a Russian where we have a lot of breadth of vision, and it's remarkable that you have all these qualities. And of course, if you read Russian literature, you begin to learn a lot about it, but a lot of people don't know. They don't know the Russians. You know, in England, we know the French. We know the Italians. We don't really know the Russians. We kind of half know the Russians. So I think in time, you know, Russians will be well known, and the better you know a nationality, the more you like it. And the more you like it, the more you can do business with it, and so on. So Russia needs to come out in a sense, and it is happening. Russians are travelling, and so on. No time for that. I'll go back to that at the end. How about the Russian identity? You know, how is it developing? Where is Russian identity? Well, as you know, for many years you had a harsh authoritarian rule for hundreds of years. Serfs were suppressed. The climate is very harsh. Imagine you live in rural Russia in winter. It's a hard life. And you had hard authoritarian rule in many centuries. And therefore Russians developed obedience and submission. But they had to protect themselves. And that usually happened in the Mir, with a village democracy. And there were thousands and thousands of Mir in Russia, where these qualities, which were really the Russian cultural identity, rural value, no? Mercy, sympathy, mutual compassion, support, assistance, spiritual ties, justice. They lived in a nice way because they had to survive. And so what does that leave you with, you know? Well, when the Soviet state was dissolved, bonds of obedience were removed. You start seeing some kind of more freedom. And you're exposed to Western values and freedoms and opportunities. And it happened very quickly, as you know, 1990, 1991. Russia started looking at the West and, you know, embracing certain qualities. But it was not always good, because you can't change the culture from one year to the next. And so what happened is that the change happened too quickly, and a lot of Russians hasty adoption of Western practices, and it led to confusion of morals, and it led to confusion of morals and aspirations. And you are tempted, you know, by material temptations and selfishness and corruption. And Russian values were distorted by the sudden change, which was a pity. But you have to reclaim the Russian cultural identity. And of course, that will happen. Because I think now a lot of Russians realize that the change was too sudden. You're not British or French, you're Russians. So where is the Russian identity, you know, coming from? You have to reclaim it. Unfortunately, you can't, because, you know, it was there, it was in the mirror. In the West, you know, individual aims, laws and decrees. Here in the mirror, it was ethics and philosophy, you know. It was good life. It was hard, but individual, you were collective. Ambition to succeed, ambition to survive. Self-advancement, don't get ahead at the expense of others. Acquire wealth, well, but share benefits equally. So you see, this was a more moral life. And that's where Russian identity really lies. Because you are unselfish. You want to help yourself. It comes out of your history. And so I have a very, you know, positive view of the Russian future. This shows, you know, this is the world, and here it shows that you are more linear in the north and more multi-active in the south. That's the reason. Eh? But what it also shows is that if you look at northern Russia, you are more about here. Now these people are very multi-active, so slightly extreme if you like, and these people in the linear active areas are very materialistic, and here they are Asians, which, you know, very reactive. But in this area here, it's fairly balanced. These areas here are fairly balanced. They're not extreme. And the Russians, I find, with all the large number of characteristics you have, you are quite balanced. And I think this will emerge. And you know, then if you begin to think of Russian diversity because of the breadth of your vision, if you have a linear active society, you have narrow perspectives because it's rather narrow and a normal performance. If you put linear active and multi-active people together, you have a broader performance, and an improved performance. If you then put Asian qualities and, you know, everybody together, you have what we call a versatile performance. What's the Russian for versatile? Nagaranyi, versatile. I wrote it down somewhere. You understand versatile? Hands up if you understand versatile. I wrote it down. Nobody understands versatile? How would you translate it?
Versatile.
I wrote it down here. Versatile is Nagostaronia Kasetsvo. Nagostaronia Kasetsvo.
Качество, да. Многостороннее качество.
Breadth of vision. Широкая визия мира.
My Russian. This is like Polish, yeah.
I know, this is your strength in life. And you know, I think that you can have a versatile performance, a many-sided. You can do many things. You know, Russians can be very practical with their hands. They can be very artistic. They understand music. They can turn their hands to many things, which some nationalities don't find. They're not so versatile. They can do one thing or two things better, but they're not many-sided. And we use the word multifaceted in English. So, you know, you have these virtues, which come out of the beard, and you have the strengths, which come out of your history. And you put all those together, you know, you are very complete Europeans, but you also have Asian, you know, things added. So we have to think, where is Russia going, you know, in the 21st century? We're a century. We've got a new century to play with. What shall we do? Eh? What are Russians going to do with it? Well, if you look back on previous centuries, in the 17th and 18th century, France was a major actor in European history. No doubt about it. All the way up to Napoleon. Then Napoleon went to Moscow and came back, and then France started going down. And in the 19th century, England dominated because of the Industrial Revolution. We got coal early. Coal enabled us to make steel and iron, and we built ships and railways, and we got an early industrial revolution. So we had a period where we dominated Europe. And now in the 20th century, of course, we had the wars, and then we had the formation of the European Union, and now Germany and France are trying to leave the European Union. And at the moment, you know, Germany is winning. The economy is much stronger than the French. But, you know, where is Russia in all this? Should Germany be the leader of Europe? You know, it's an open question. Because they're only 80 million, you know, they're not the biggest country in Europe. Germany is most prosperous. What is Russia's role? And then, when you look at Russia in a positive manner, you know, first of all, you have to think that you have many time zones, and you're all across the globe, all the way from St. Petersburg to Vladivostok, Kamchatka. Big country. And more important than a big country, you have, I think, about 15 borders with other countries. You have 15 neighbors, all the way from Finland and Latvia to China. And, you know, so you have many, many land neighbors. Therefore, Russia can never become an isolated country. It can't. You know, America, if they want to be isolated, they can say, okay, Canada, they're friendly. Mexico, we're not interested. We are withdrawing from Europe. We will be isolated. I'm not standing on my knees. So heck with everybody else. Russia can't do that. You are involved with 15 different countries' land borders and war with the sea. So Russia can never be an isolated country. So therefore, you know, she can never be just a simple, detached nation, remote from others' affairs. Can't happen, because it's a joke. Therefore, she has no option but to aspire to Eurasian leadership. One day, you have to be the leader, because who else is going to unite China and Lithuania, you know? No. So you have a big role to play. And then when you think of that role, which must happen sooner or later, and probably sooner than later, you must think of the strengths, you know, the candidacy for Russian leadership is significant. And look how strong it is. First of all, the breadth of vision I'm talking about enables leadership quality. The vast land area gives you multiple international connections. Only Russia can serve as a bridge between East and West. Additionally, at sea, she is a Pacific power, an Arctic power, and an Antarctic power. You know, in the next 20, 30 years, the Arctic is going to be very important. One of the important parts of the world. It's getting warm. And the shortest route from Asia to Europe is over the Arctic. 50% faster than going through Suez and North Africa. So you are going to develop the Arctic, along with Canada. But Russia has a biggest part. Her vast resources in oil, gas and minerals will give you a strong economy. They last for quite a long time. Your historical artistic record is as strong as anybody. Literature, music, opera, ballet, painting, sculpture confirms her cultural and moral preeminence on a par with any other major European country. So historically and artistically you have the strength. And finally, you have a population of 145 million, which is by far the biggest country in Europe. So why should Germany leave Europe or France leave Europe? You know, it's not a question of being in the European Union or not. That's a different matter. But you are still in Europe. A lot of you are here. We are in Europe here. So you see, Russia should probably have an important role in this century. And young people like you are part of it. So I like to finish on an optimistic note. Maybe you think I'm too optimistic, but that's my view. But, as we said in the earlier part of the program, you have to go out, you have to mix with other people, you have to show Russian strengths and make business with the world. So you can start with Europe first. I think that's all. Any questions?
Let's get questions, if there are questions.
Question.
Well, the obvious one, of course, is that.
Pardon?
The obvious one is that you told us everything about the mission of Russia, and I'm pretty sure that people sitting in this room might have reflected upon this and they have their own opinions.
Of course.
But what do you tell us about the mission of Britain? Just give us an example so we compare. Because
of course, it's a good question. And, you know, I mean, all countries, they think of missions, you know. The Americans still think of missions. France still think of missions. People think in that way, and it's good they do. Britain, you know, in the 19th century was lucky because an industrial revolution is a huge thing. They're the first people, you know, to make the steam engine, which, because we had the coal. If we had not had the coal, we had a lot of coal, we would not have been able to make steel and iron. And if we couldn't make steel and iron, we couldn't make railways and all the things you make from steel and iron. And we had a 50-year start before the other countries, including Germany, developed their coal and their steel and iron. So we were very lucky. And we made an empire, as you know, a very big empire. But like all empires, it went away. All we have left is Gibraltar, I think, or a couple of places like that. But no, Britain feels, if you want to ask what is Britain's mission, we feel that we have a lot of moral authority, for sure. We feel that we have a lot of moral authority and that our parliament was a model for other parliaments, including the American Constitution. And so we have not abandoned our kind of view of morality, that we in general standards, we are a moral people who could be imitated with benefits. I think that's our mission. We are not thinking of conquering the world anymore. No. We are a small country, 50 million, but we think we have good moral stance. And you know, we have this problem now, do we stay in the European Union or not? It's a lot to do with our standard of life and with India or not. The French have this mission of civilizing everybody else. I think it's ambitious, small country. But I think Russia will develop a mission. You are a very, very big country, very big and very important. And it will come. But as you say, you know, everybody has a different opinion. Some of you may be much more pessimistic. But I see some things which maybe only an outsider sees. I think your cultural characteristics are very, very broad. That is for sure. You see things that a lot of nationalities would not see. Hmm? I'm sorry if I'm too optimistic.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would step back for one of your topics about cross-cultural misunderstanding,
yes,
and cross-cultural conflicts and the linguistic problems. As you say, your British don't like learn different languages because you don't need to learn, and because everybody can speak English here around the world. But if we came, for example, to China or to Germany, and we have some communication problem with, say, China, different ways of communications. We can speak Chinese, we can speak French, or we can speak English, which is not native and not our culture for both of us. What is the best way, do you think, to resolve cross-cultural conflicts in such a way?
Because of language.
Because when we try to speak Chinese, it means we step on their side. When we try to speak Russian, they need to step on our side. When we speak English, we step in the middle, but mostly ours, but this is not our both native language. Maybe it's better to have a translator from Russian to Chinese, or better to speak bad English, which is bad for both of us. That is just German for
it's
France.
It's a good question, and it's a very big question, and you can't answer it in one word. You see, if you look at it statistically, the world now has a lingua franca, and that is English. Statistically, there are more people speak English than any other language except Chinese. There are more people speak Chinese, but Chinese is not a lingua franca. Chinese is a difficult language to learn for two reasons. One, the writing system is very complicated. You have to learn about 10,000 different characters instead of 26 letters. And certainly the tones make it very difficult. So it is unlikely that Chinese will become a world language. Unlikely. It's not impossible. English is not the only lingua franca in the world. We, in our school in England, 3 years ago, we had five people came from different patent offices. Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Azerbaijan, Tajikistan,
and
Turkmenistan.
That's okay. They all speak Russian.
They all spoke Russian, and they all spoke Turkish, except Tajik, who spoke Persian. But all the other four spoke Turkish, and they spoke Russian. And they were in our house for 3 weeks, and they all talked Russian together in their relaxed time, although they were learning English. In another sense, French has been, of course, a world language, and still is in French Africa. German has never been a world language, Italian has never been a world language, but you can say French and English, and to some extent Spanish, because of South America, is a lingua franca. When you're Russians and you're going abroad, you have to make a choice. And I would think that the normal choice which most of you are making, you know, is English, because you're all living examples of Russians who learned English at a high level in this room. Is it so easy to get a room full of Russians speaking such good Chinese? Is it so easy to get them such a room full of speaking French? So, you know, English is an option. But, you know, if you want optimal results, you probably need extremely good interpreters, because you may find that you're dealing with a country whose level of English is not sufficient, and then you need interpreters. There are different options.
Yes, but my question was not a lingua franca of the common language. My question was of how, what is the best way to resolve these cross-cultural conflicts when, in the sense of language, when you have an interpreter from one language to another, or when you have the middle language?
Well, I think it's case by case. I would, if I'm taking you and the director and our friend here, I don't know his name, if you were dealing with English business people, I would have no hesitation in saying that the best, in this particular case, you should all speak English, because your English is the level that you can do it. If you are dealing with people whose level is lower, then it's case by case. You have to look at it, you know. Their English is not quite good enough, they don't speak good enough Spanish, so we have to interpret it. The best, of course, is if everybody speaks the same language, but that doesn't happen. But you go a long way with English. You can't answer the question totally. You can only say it's case by case, and if you're not sure of the level on both sides, then you need interpreters, and you need good interpreters, because a bad interpreter is the worst of all, to understand. Yeah. Right, what's your next question?
Plus we're finishing at 7, so we'll get 6 minutes left. Who would like to ask a question?
I'll give a comment.
Okay, and then I'll give up.
Yeah, it's a comment. I really like you in France trying to civilize Europe, and I thought if it was
sure,
actually... what I'm saying is that I like your perspective on the France trying to civilize Europe.
The French?
Yeah. And I thought maybe it's like a British view on that, obviously.
Yeah.
But then I just recently read, and I think it was BBC website, and maybe The Economist, who quoted from General de Gaulle, who like 50 years ago, he said, Europe is it's a coach with horses, where Germany is the horses, and France is the coachman.
A very good summary, yeah.
So I think it's... Yeah. Very good comparison.
Yeah. But you know, I remember regarding what you said, I'll tell you something interesting. There was a survey done, a German businessman, 2 or 3 years ago, a very serious survey, in theory, university survey. And they asked these German businessmen which language they preferred to do business in. And they said English. And they said, well, okay, English, fine, you know, you go to France, or, but why not German? Wouldn't you be happier learning German? Using German. And they said, we find But I know English is good, we mean good English, but when we do business in English, we do better business. They said, well, why? We are more reliant. We have more of a sense of humour. But the language is leading our thoughts. And as you know, if you've studied Benjamin Worf or Sapphire, your language controls your thought. Yes.
When you change language, you change your mentality.
You change your mentality, absolutely. And you know the English and the Americans are more relaxed than the Germans. So you, when a German is doing business, let's say, with a Frenchman who speaks English, and you get into a deadlock, there is not a mechanism in the German language to relax that deadlock or to solve that deadlock problem. Whereas in English and American, there is a machinery by either the use of humor or the way they speak, the way they address, to, you know, make it a solution more likely. Germans say this, and most Germans say we usually get a result when we're negotiating in English, and when we're negotiating in German, it's sometimes too stiff. That was a survey. I believe it, but it wasn't my survey. You are smiling. Why are you smiling?
What? What? You mean that this fixed Ordnung in German?
It's not a relaxed language, and the verb comes at the end, so you have to listen very carefully to everything they say before you know whether the result with 500 voters in a certain place on this certain subject at a certain time was finally, last word, rejected or accepted. You have to wait till the end to know what happened. So the German is a rather straitjacket language, a bit stiff. But maybe Russian's a very good language. I don't know Russian language well enough. Maybe Russian is a rich language where you can use it as a lingua franca very effectively. I mean, certainly these Tajiks and Kazakhs and Uzbeks who are in our house, they use Russian fluently. Yeah. I wish I spoke Russian. And I'm sure that Russian has certain characteristics as a language, because the language is on time. But all languages have certain characteristics. Certainly, English is a language with inbuilt humor and relaxation. Japanese is a very different language. It's very vague. It's very hard to know what people have said in Japanese, because they're so polite to each other that everything gets lost in the fog of politeness. And you don't know whether they've agreed or not. Because if they've agreed, they say yes, yes, yes. And if they've not agreed, they say yes, yes, yes. Why not? And even Japanese dealing with Japanese, they sometimes have to have a meeting two or three times before they find out what the other side actually thinks. A real question, a real problem in Japanese. A language, I didn't talk about it much today, but the interaction between language and culture, behavior, is very important and a very interesting subject. But you can pick two ways. You can say, I'm thinking in English, but I make my own thoughts, I dominate my own thoughts. Or the opposite, I am thinking in English, therefore I can only think certain things. I can never understand what you mean in Russian by, what is it, dusha? I don't know what dusha means. I'm not Russian. How do I know? What does saudades mean in Portuguese, you know? What does sisu mean in Finnish? You only know if you know the language.
Okay. Richard, one last question just to let you reflect not about dusha or dusha, but reflect about things you know, once again.
Reflect about what?
Things you know. So, you gave us beautiful examples of differences in business cultures, like America, Britain, France. What explains the fact that successful consultants in cross-cultural communication are British? Is there something in British business culture which helps sell this type of product?
Maybe I could give you a rough idea. A rough idea. Again, it's a very difficult question to answer. But you know, in the 19th century, we had this industrial revolution. And the industrial revolution enabled us to create an empire of 15 million square miles, which is something like 30 million square kilometers. The biggest empire the world has ever known. We didn't keep it very long. But during that 150 years, when we had this empire, we were in Africa, we were in India, we were in Southeast Asia, and we put in our colonial offices.
And these colonial officers, their job very often was to make judgments between different tribes. So if you go to Nigeria, you're not dealing just with a Nigerian, you're dealing with 50 different tribes. Well, let's say it's only two, you know, the north and the south, if you like. The British very often had to judge a situation. And they would normally do it by sitting in a chair in a village, and the chief of one tribe would come here, the chief of the other tribe come there, and you would hear what he said, and hear what he said, and they'd hate each other, of course, and then you have to make a judgment. So we consider ourselves arbiters, judges, and that is a strong feeling even today in the British character, is that we can hear, you know, and also we have a parliamentary democracy. So we hear all sides of a question, and then because we have to, because I'm a colonial officer 100 years ago, I make a judgment. Now that could be related to what you just asked. Could be. Yeah. But of course the other famous cross-culturalists are both Dutch, but they worked in English. They used English to work.
Well, okay, then history reveals us the secrets of successes and things right now. Well, let us thank Mr. Lewis for this long and hopefully effective presentation for your practical and scholarly needs.
Thank you very much for your attention today. And I know it's hard to meet a stranger for the first time and then listen for 4 hours. It's not easy. And I noticed yesterday and the day before when I was in the other university, the first day they were like you. They were very nice and very friendly, not a little shy. The second day they were not shy at all. And we had quite long debates on the second, well, not long debates, but we had a lot of exchange on the second day. And I think Russians are like that. You don't rush to a conclusion. You're reflective people. You know, you've had a long history, very variegated, checkered history, and I think you like to think about things and gradually come to conclusions. And I'm sorry I'm not here tomorrow, because we could have continued, and I'm sure I would have had a lot more feedback from the audience. Of course, we got feedback from the older people who are more used to this kind of discussion. But yesterday I was experiencing that from some young people. Unfortunately, they were also reasonably optimistic about, you know, the Russian picture, which I am. And I don't apologize for it. I just feel that a lot of things are within your reach. Mm. All right.
Okay.
Lovely to meet you all, and I hope to see you again. One of you.
Okay, thank you.